Hi, this is Kane Hodder, Victor Crowley, Jason from Friday the 13th. You're listening to WithoutYourHead.com.
And right off the bat, we're joined by R.A. Mihailov, who's better known as Leatherface from Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, and he's also in the upcoming sequel to Hatchet, Hatchet 2, which we're going to talk about. We're big fans of Hatchet 1. How you doing tonight?
Ashley Neal, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good.
How's Jittery John?
Oh, I'm very jittery tonight.
Oh, so a good deal. And how about Terrible Troy?
Oh, I'm feeling pretty terrible tonight, so everything's good.
Excellent, excellent.
Yep.
Well, good deal. Good to hear from you guys. Thanks for having me on the show.
Oh, thanks for doing it.
My pleasure.
Are you allowed to say what the RA stands for?
I am certainly allowed to because it belongs to me.
All right.
But I'm not going to tell you.
Oh, man.
Oh, man.
Come on. If I wanted people to know my full name, I'd bill myself by my full name, right?
I suppose so.
Well, yeah. It actually stands for Roman Alexander Mihailov.
No, that's a pretty cool name. I dig that.
Yeah, that it's a complete lie, too.
Oh, man.
That was good, though, huh?
Don't tell us.
Yeah.
I know, it sounds really good, and I've actually considered, redoing my whole image,
mm-hmm.
and going for that kind of mysterious, sophisticated European kind of, Eastern Europe kind of deal.
I can see that.
I would blow it, because I'm kind of like a goober. I'm kind of like a, grew up in the country and stuff like that, and I wouldn't be able to maintain it very well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but just more like a badass.
About this, I'd be on like Jay Leno or something, and, oh, yes, Jay, perhaps you do not recall the time we met each other at the bike rally. Yes. And then cut, wow, thanks, Roman Alexander. Now, our next guest, Pamela Anderson. Holy Christ, look at the boobs on that broad. There goes my European sophistication, so I'm not even going to bother.
That would blow your cover.
Yeah, if you had a Vlad the Impaler mustache, I don't think anyone would question it. That's your next step. Do that, then you can pass off, You can
do the what now? Say that one more time.
You got to get a Vlad the Impaler mustache to go along with that name.
Ah, there you go. Well, one of my good friends suggested I dye my hair black, Maybe that would, with a big... A big black goatee, maybe like handlebar mustache.
Well, I dig that. Kind of put some oil on it, grease on it, get it real nice and thin.
Mm. Yeah, you know what? I mean, it was a nice idea for about 30 seconds, but I can't maintain it, so I'm not even going to bother.
All right.
It
was fun while it lasted.
Yeah. And, So I'm just gonna have to be who I am.
Yeah, that's who else can you be, really?
Yeah, well, in the famous words of Popeye the Sailor, I am what I am.
No, when you took the role in as Leatherface, were you a fan of the previous films?
Oh, absolutely! I've been a lifelong horror fan, and so you can imagine my thrill. When I was picked to play Leatherface in number 3, I was ecstatic. And the fact that it was directed by a very, very good friend of mine, increased that excitement and joy exponentially.
Mm-hmm. Now, I actually saw that in on the specials on the DVD. They talked about, you guys knew each other for a long time, Jeff Burr, and he had you in, his college movie.
In his student film, yes.
Yeah. Well, what was that? What was that movie?
It was called Divided We Fall. It was a Civil War period piece. He and a classmate, Kevin Meyer, made this epic student film at USC. And they were able to recruit some really cool people for it. John Agar was in the movie. Remember John Agar? You better remember John Agar.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he was in the movie. Nick Guest was in the movie. I'm trying to think who else. It's been a while, But they actually won. They won the same award that Steven Spielberg won for his equivalent film. And it was just a really, really good film, man. I mean, we had like full-on battles with cavalry and cannons and stuff like that. It was just really cool for a student film.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, it was way cool. And so we just had so much fun doing that and bonded so deeply over that experience that we remained friends for all the intervening years. And then when he got hired to direct Chainsaw 3, this is no secret, really. He actually offered the part to Gunnar out of a sense of reverence or whatever, you know. And fortunately for me, Gunnar was unable to conclude a successful deal with New Line and left the part open. And, of course, I was the next logical choice. And, I'm very glad. I'm very glad the way it happened. And, like I said, I was thrilled. Was thrilled, am thrilled, and will be thrilled to the day I die to have done that part.
Yeah. You talked about Gunnar Hansen. Did you go back? Well, you probably already knew the movie, but did you, once you got the role, did you, study how the other guys played Leatherface, or did you want to do your own thing, or?
Actually, no, I didn't. I'd seen the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre when it came out in the theaters, and I remembered it, very vividly. And then I remember seeing number two as well. But I think we talked. I think there was a conscious decision for me not to watch any of the other two, so that I wouldn't be kind of unduly influenced by previous work. So I didn't watch them before I did the part.
We got a caller here. He keeps calling in, so he must have a very important question here. So we're going to
find out what he wants.
Yeah. I think it's Robbie. Do you have a question?
That's right. I personally think the second sequel to the Texas Chainsaw Massacre was the best. I hated number two, and I hated number four. How would you feel if they remade the third one?
If I was in it, I'd be thrilled.
And one quick fact.
Say that again.
I have a quick tidbit to tell you.
Uh-oh. Go ahead.
All right.
I am a Mormon, and that is one of the cases that the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie was based on. Mm-hmm. This strange dude.
Ed Gein?
No, this was a different guy. Definitely not.
Kind of scary.
He's been on the run for a while. It's good.
Well, I've never heard that till this moment in time. I've never heard anything about Mormons being involved or inspiring any of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre stuff.
Mm. Well, no, it wasn't them. It was these two missionaries.
Very proud of this.
Was two missionaries?
Yeah, they visited this lonely guy in the heart of Texas, and they disappeared.
Hmm.
And they
For some reason, as soon as you said Mormon, I began to think Utah.
Mm. Yeah.
No, I live in Utah.
All right. I'll buy that. It sounds good.
Yeah.
Sounds plausible.
All right. Maybe they'll make the Mormon Chainsaw Massacre at some point.
The gears in my mind are turning.
All right. Thanks for calling in, Robbie.
Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah, thank you, Robbie. Thank you for that.
Now, you mentioned the second one, which is much more comedy.
Yeah. Who are you still talking? No, Robbie's gone, right?
Yeah. Did you like the second movie?
Yeah, I liked it. Though I must say my personal preference for horror is straight up unrelenting horror with comic relief. I don't mind comic relief because you almost need comic relief to give you a place to go back to and from, so that when the lighter moments make the darker moments even darker,
Yep.
But I don't like straight out campy or punny or, don't dream and drive. I hated that line forever.
Yeah. Well, that was one of the worst Nightmare on Elm Street. So.
Yeah, but, you know, I like Nightmare on Elm Street. I'm a big horror fan. You know, there's very little that bothers me, but I'll tell you one movie I hated so much. I don't care who knows about it. There was a movie I hated so much that I'd gotten a screener copy of it on back in, when we only had VHS.
Mm-hmm.
I played it one afternoon, and I was so disgusted by the movie, I pulled the cassette the video cassette out of my machine, threw it on my living room floor, and stomped it to pieces.
Whoa!
What movie was this?
Chopper Chicks in Zombie Town. I'm totally into bike. You know, hey, I'm totally into bike and stuff. But first of all, what's a chopper chick? Forget it. It should have been, you know, pick your favorite motorcycle club in Zombie Town. Okay, first of all, it shouldn't have been a bunch of chicks. Although I get the gimmick. You know, you want a bunch of chicks riding around. I'm sorry, don't work for me. It was just the worst movie I've ever seen, and so offensive to me that I had to destroy it.
That was the only copy.
The movie, I guess, you know, was a fairly a big deal. You know, it was one of Billy Bob Thornton's first starring roles.
Oh,
really?
Is it really?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, you guys never heard the title?
I've never seen it. I've never seen the movie.
I've heard the title, but I've never seen it either. I gotta go see if it's on Netflix.
Ah, I bet it is.
Is he Carl in it?
Anything like what?
Carl from Sling Blade?
Oh, not at all. Not at all. You know, I mean, the fact is, I don't even think I knew who Billy Bob Thornton was when I saw the movie. You know, that's how far back I'm talking, like early 90s, you know, or very early 90s.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Jane Wiedlin from the Go-Go's was in it.
Oh, really?
I think so. You know, like I told you earlier, I can't get on my computer today, or I would double check this as we were speaking. But oh yeah, it was just but oh my God, it was just the horriblest movie I've ever seen in my life. You know, I mean, listen, I'm all for 100% for a good balls to the wall, true depiction, kick ass biker horror movie. I actually aspire to make one sometime in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's not the problem. It was just the execution was just so bad.
Yeah. I got here on IMDb, and it's got 2.8 out of 10 stars.
Yeah. I give it a minus 0. whatever out of, you know, whatever. But, yeah, I hated it. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm off my soapbox now.
Yeah. Sorry, any fans of Chopper Chicks and Zombie Town out there.
Don't look like there's too many.
No, I don't think there is. But did you get to keep any of the props from the movie?
No, hardly anything. You know, first of all, when I did the movie, I didn't realize that there was an ancillary world out there of conventions and haunted attractions and autograph shows and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I had no idea that any of this stuff had any value other than sentimental, and I'm not particularly sentimental. So, no, I kept very little. I think I grabbed a couple of skulls off the house set, just because I like skulls.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, no, I didn't keep the chainsaw, though I know.
That thing was sweet. I think I would have tried to sneak off with that.
You're not even going to believe how the guy I finally, after all these years, found out who has it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not allowed. I've sworn to secrecy. I'm not allowed to reveal who it is. But the way he got it, he was, you know, obviously somebody that was around the set, and it was just, according to him, it was just basically laying there, and he asked if he could have it.
Wow.
Damn.
Yeah, and they gave it to him.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Does he ever let you borrow it for like the conventions or anything?
We've talked about that a lot. You know, we've actually talked about since he revealed, himself to me. We have talked about that a lot. But the logistics of it are kind of difficult, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big-ass chainsaw, and how am I going to get it to, you know, Chiller?
Yeah. Can't exactly you know? Get that on the plane. You want to bring a chainsaw on the plane, sir?
Yeah, exactly. You know? So... The idea has, you know, absolutely been on the table, but the practicality of it kind of, you know, squelched everything.
Mm. Do people ever make like recreations of the chainsaws? Look at all the action figures and stuff out there.
Yeah, not so much, you know, replicas or anything like that, but many times people will bring in their own chainsaw. I've had, you know, people tell me they've gone out and bought one just for the occasion. You know, sometimes people, if they're handy enough, they'll take the bar out of it, and they'll just bring the bar so they don't have to carry the whole chainsaw. But, you know, over the years, yeah, I've signed many, many chainsaws. But truthfully, I do not ever recall signing a replica.
Yeah. Yeah, that one really sticks out of all the movies, the Chainsaw Man 3.
Mm-hmm, with the chrome blade and the engraving.
Yeah.
You know what,
that's just awesome.
Yeah, you know what the name for the saw was on the set? They called it the Excalibur saw.
Oh, really?
Nice.
Uh-huh, and part of that was influenced by the fact that, do you recall the trailer at all?
Yeah, I do, with the Lady of the Lake, like, reaching up with the chainsaw.
Exactly,
right?
Yep, that's exactly the intent. And they actually hired the company that did the trailer for the movie Excalibur to recreate a shot by shot, you know, trailer.
Yeah.
Wow.
Hmm.
Yeah, and so therefore it was very natural to call that saw the Excalibur saw.
That's awesome.
Yeah. But now here's something very, very few people know.
Mm-hmm.
That was not me in the trailer.
Really?
Oh, no.
Yeah, huh? How about that?
Who was it?
Don't know. I have no idea.
And if you ever find that guy.
No, I don't want to find him. I hope he's retired. I hope he's out of the business and, you know, living in a suburb somewhere.
I was going to say you're going to give him a good stomping, so.
No harm. All he did was some guy, you know, he didn't do anything against me. He's just some poor schlub that needed a job, you know.
he was the director of Jackson Zombie Town.
Huh?
I said he was the director of Chopper Chicks in Zombie Town.
Well, you know, watch me shoot off my mouth about that movie and find out that guy is some, like, big horror director now. He was actually considering me for a part in his next movie, and that all went to hell.
Headshot in the trash.
Yep.
What was your favorite scene in the movie?
I think the stuff we did around the dinner table in the house.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was just, you know, it was just so, I can't think of the word. It was just so bent, you know. I mean, from my perspective, I mean, you know, villains never think they're villains, right?
Right,
right.
What they
they're doing what they're doing for whatever reason they're doing it, and in their minds is justified. So, you know, my idea for that for the stuff around the dinner table was we weren't there to be evil. We weren't there to be vicious or mean or anything like that. We were just a normal family, doing family things. So when the little girl comes in with her mummified, monkey, skull doll baby,
mm-hmm.
That's just life. That's just normal life for us. You know, she came, I don't know if you remember it very well, but she came in and, I come in with the Excalibur saw. I put it on the dinner table. I grab a rag, a bloody rag, no less, and use it to, you know, start wiping down the saw. She comes in. I think she showed me her little skeleton doll. I think it was a monkey skeleton, or maybe it was a baby skeleton. I don't know. But she shows me a little doll, and I, you know, I think that's really nice. I pat her on the butt, and she gives me a kiss on the cheek, and
sits
on my lap. You know, we're just a normal. It's not. We were a normal in our minds. We were a normal family doing normal family things, and I think that makes it so much more
creepier,
macabre, or whatever you want to say.
Wondering. I just had that one quick side note. That little girl looks so familiar to me. Is she the one that's in the Addams Family movies?
No, but
it's not her. No.
Oh, but you have good reason to think she's familiar because that was her second horror film. She had been in one of the Friday the 13th movies earlier.
Oh no, kidding.
Uh huh. I can't remember which number.
If I had to guess, I'd say number 6. There's some kids in there.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not sure, but that's what they had told me, that she had been in, you know, one of the Friday 13th movies. So she was already, you know, even at that young age, she was already a veteran
of horror movies.
Now, I think you mentioned on the commentary track that, like, you thought that kid was supposed to be your daughter in the movie.
Right.
Yeah. In your head, how, like, would that have come about? Would have been like one of your victims? You raped her and kept her around, or
if you'll think back again to the movie, when we have Kate Hodge nailed to the chair, I come in, and I guess it's mostly the way they framed it. Most of the action takes place off camera, but what was happening is I was starting. You know, I come in and I kind of like kneel down in front of her. And lean in. Well, what you don't really see a lot is that as I'm leaning in, I'm stroking her legs.
Oh.
And then Viggo comes in and goes, he has a line, something like, Junior makes pretty babies, or something like that.
Yep, that's so, right.
So that's what I think was, usual par for the course is, we get female victims, we parse them out to whoever's turn it is, and, we make the next generation.
I think that was the first one where there was any women shown in the family.
Is it really?
I think so. I don't think there's no women in the first one or the second one in the family.
Oh, well, Grandma's there as a mummy.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, that's true.
Ah.
In number two.
Yeah.
And then number four, you know, the psychiatrist lady turns out to be part of the family.
Yeah, but I meant up to that point. The only
you're right. I had until this. Wow, this is a day for revelation. Until this minute, I never thought about that.
Yeah, I was a big fan of Grandpa in part three. Just sitting at
the table. I'm sure he appreciates that very much. And. Give me your address and I'll get you an autograph from him. I hope you know that was a joke, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, I'll send it right now.
He was a dummy. Now, here's something interesting. Speaking of women in the movie, you know, the woman that played my mother, the woman in the wheelchair.
Mm-hmm.
You know who her son is?
No.
No.
Well, I am going to tell you right now. Perhaps you've heard of a movie called Feast.
Oh, yeah.
Perhaps you've heard of the director, John Gallagher.
Yeah, we've had him on the show.
That's his mother.
Really?
No.
Uh-huh.
I did not know that.
That's awesome.
Uh-huh. How cool is that?
The whole family does movies.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. John, how cool was that?
John Gallagher has the, and I mean this in the nicest way because he was an awesome guest on the show, but he has the sleaziest giggle I've ever heard.
He does. You know, I see John quite often, and I guess I never really listened to him giggle.
He did a lot on our show.
Maybe that's
what we were talking about, yeah.
That's coming from a guy named Nasty Neil, so. Can't really take it.
Yeah, there you go.
He knows his sleazy laughs, that guy.
Yeah. I didn't mean that as an insult. It's a great laugh. I dig it.
Yep.
Was there any talks to show Leatherface without the mask?
That is a damn fine question, and I'm so glad you asked that because that allows me to expound on something.
All right, cool.
There was absolute discussion on whether to reveal the face at the end. Mm-hmm. But because New Line had licensed the characters for two more sequels, the thought was to save the reveal for a later edition. Mm-hmm. So I had actually signed a contract with New Line for an option to do number four and number five.
What happened there?
Another excellent question, and I'm very glad to tell you what happened. I was young, dumb, and stupid. Am I allowed to say, is this the internet,
you
right?
You can say anything you want.
I was young, dumb, and full of cum, and I didn't know any better. I didn't know you needed a lawyer. I thought they loved me down there. They gave me a contract that for two more movies, and each time my money doubled on every single movie, subsequent sequel, the money doubled, and I thought they must be absolutely in love with me and that my future was so bright that I was going to have to wear sunglasses the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. And I thought I was on my way to being, one of the true icons of horror from that point on. Mm-hmm. Well, what I did not realize was, first of all, it wasn't my contract, it was their contract. By that I mean it was all written in their favor. It was if they want to use me for number four and number five, it was their option to exercise, not mine. And then I found out later, after doing a little due diligence, that the reason my money doubled on each time is because that's what the union requires on successive sequels.
Mm. Oh. So it wasn't out of the kindness of their heart. Right.
It wasn't a reward for me, to me, for a splendid performance or anything like that. It was basic agreement.
Yeah.
So anyway, I didn't but like I said, I did not realize that it was a non-binding or whatever you want to call it contract, and it was all for, it was their contract option, not mine.
Mm-hmm.
And then what happened was. And again, I still didn't know, so I thought probably within 1 or 2 years, I would get a call back to service and we would do another, Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Mm-hmm. The calls didn't come. So I sat down and wrote a prequel thinking perhaps, I needed to prime the pump a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So I took it down to New Line and they wrote me back a letter and said, thank you, for sending us this screenplay. And, unfortunately, we don't feel that there's any more life. I'm paraphrasing. I don't remember exactly what it said, but we don't feel there's any more life in the Texas Chainsaw series. So therefore, we're going to pass on the project. However, if you manage to get it made on your own, we would be more than, happy to screen it for possible distribution. Somebody at New Line had authorized them paying a ton of money to license the title and characters for the sequels, but because it did not make a major impact at the box office, even though it was number 11 the week it opened, after we lost our original opening date was November 3rd, 1989,
mm-hmm.
And it didn't open until February of 1990. We lost that Halloween momentum.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
I'm pretty sure had it opened at its original date, it would have absolutely been obviously it would have absolutely been in the top 10 and probably. Top five, mm-hmm. As it was, in a no man's land, nether time, still came in at number 11.
Mm-hmm.
Plus another thing, I'm not going to mention any names, but, I found out after the fact several years later that there were a couple of, people at New Line who wanted New Line to get out of the low budget horror business.
Yeah.
And they were not supportive of the project at all.
Hmm.
to the point where, you know, they almost, you know, tried to throw a wrench in the gears.
Mm-hmm.
Man.
So that's all I will say about that.
Yeah.
I will say that each of them ended up directing horror movies themselves. Bitter irony, you know.
Yeah.
But that's what I heard. I mean, I heard it from what I consider a very reliable source, so I choose to believe that, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Had the full weight of New Line management been behind the project, it would have made a much bigger impact than it did.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what's a lot that. I'll try to make a long story short, but it's obviously too late for that. So what happened was, you know, New Line allowed their option on, you know, the licensing's option to revert back to Vortex. And so that was the end of New Line in the chainsaw business.
Mm-hmm.
And when it went back to Vortex, that was when Kim Henkel, you know, I assume he's part of Vortex, you know, took over or regained the rights or the title and went forward with, you know, number four, or the, what is it called, the New Beginning?
Yeah. Return of Texas Chainsaw Massacre, I think it's called.
Yeah, well, which, you know, was actually made around 1993.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it took a long time to come out, but then I think when both the stars became like pretty big stars, then they finally got it released.
Precisely, and that was about 1997, I think.
Yeah.
You know, it languished in no man's land for several years, and I think it was heading the way of a previously mentioned title. until all of a sudden a couple of kids, you know, shot to stardom. Renee Zellweger and Matthew McConaughey, of course,
mm-hmm.
and that resurrected it. You know,
mm-hmm. Were you a fan of that movie?
I've seen it, and you know, I do not like Leatherface wearing a dress. And I think, if I recall, I don't know if it ever came through official channels, but you know, somebody had, you know, kind of sent an inquiry to me if I'd be interested in doing it. And I made it known that, you know, I wasn't interested in working on a non-union picture, which is what I think. I don't know 100%, but I think that was a non-union picture. And that, you know, I wasn't interested in wearing a dress. So, you know, I'm sorry. I understand that is, you know, one of the peculiarities of Ed Gein,
but
it ain't for me, man.
I don't think they have to go all the way, you know, that far with it. But
I think the high heels and fishnets were a little over the top.
Yeah, you know? I'd say so. But I applaud your decision not to get a star in that one. So,
well, thank you. You know, I don't think that, you know, truthfully though, I have to be absolutely candid. There was never a hard offer on the table. There was just sort of like, you know, people being go-betweens, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it didn't go very far.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
Some people might not remember the third one if they haven't seen it for a while, might not, you know, realize Viggo Mortensen's in it, and, you know, he went on to be a huge star. What was he like at the time?
Oh, great. You know, I mean, obviously, I wish I'd palled up with him more. but, you know, I mean, he was a consummate professional. There's absolutely no doubt about that. You know, he always came to the set prepared, you know, always had ideas, took everything, you know, very seriously. And it's easy to see why he has, you know, reached the heights that he has.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, he and I really didn't have a whole lot of scenes together. And weren't on the set together a lot,
mm-hmm.
but I remember very vividly one thing. It was instinctual. He's a very, very smart actor, and I remember in the kitchen. I don't know if you guys remember that, but when then the character Tinkerbell comes in and gives me when he first gives me the Excalibur saw, and Viggo comes in and goes, you got you a present, huh? And I kind of like, you know, shake my head like a little kid, you know, and I pick it up and I start swinging it around. And I came a little close to Viggo, and he kind of just like ducked under it. And it wasn't rehearsed or anything, but it was just like an absolutely beautiful instinctual moment. I'll never forget it. I was very impressed by that.
Yeah. Now, I actually I heard you in another interview. You said that you've used chainsaws before you did the movie, but you were left-handed, so
here's the deal. Yes, exactly. You know, and I knew that I had to start using the chainsaw right-handed. Thank God I didn't have to buck a cord of firewood with it. Okay. You know, but I'd been working construction for, you know, off and on for several years. So, and I was working construction just before I did the movie. So, you know, once I knew I had the movie, I started using my power tools right-handed whenever I could,
mm-hmm.
just to get in the habit.
No, were you ever like thought, well, maybe this is kind of dangerous, me swinging around this giant chainsaw? I know obviously they didn't have the you could probably still do some damage with it.
There were some times actually when, you know, we were using a full-on fully toothed blade and things like that,
mm-hmm.
and I've seen you know, well, I was there obviously, and I saw it when it happened, but you can see it in the movie. One time when I'm walking through the woods, I'm actually cutting branches, you know, as I'm walking mm-hmm. through the woods. Not a big deal or really focused thing, but you know, I am clearing a little path through the brush at one point. But no, I never felt any trepidation whatsoever. You know, I mean, let's face it, it was a, for all intents and purposes, it was a big, you know, as far as these things go, it was a big budget quasi-studio film. I was in, you know, I felt that, you know, the personnel on the crew had to be top-notch, and if everybody did their job, there was nothing to worry about.
Mm-hmm.
So, no, I never had any reservations about doing anything on the picture.
Yeah. Now, what were your thoughts of your big battle with Ken Faree?
That was a great fight scene. I loved that one.
Yeah. It was great. I mean, yeah. What can I say? It was fantastic. It was great. Ken's a big man. Ken's almost, he's as big as I am. Oh, I didn't say that. No, Ken's really big. So there were two, you know, there were two behemoths, bashing around, you know, and, you know, let's face it. I mean, it's no secret. When you're doing a fight scene, you're not really fighting. A fight scene in a movie or on stage is more akin really to, dare I say dance than it is a real fight. You know what I mean?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your moves are all rehearsed, worked out ahead of time. You're trying not to hurt each other. You know, when everybody goes home at the end of the day unhurt, then that's a good day. Plus we were in water, and so that cushioned a lot of, you know, I mean, there was no hard landing or anything like that.
Yeah.
So, you know, but yeah, it was a really good fight scene. Did you know that Ken was actually supposed to die in that pit?
Yeah, I mean, it pretty much showed his head getting sawed, and then he kind of pops up at the end of the movie.
Uh-huh. Yeah. That was a decision made by Bob Shea, the owner of New Line. He liked the character of Benny so much, Ken's character, that he decided he wanted to bring him back in one of the...
like the sequels?
Yeah, it's one of the sequels. The unmaterialized sequels. So that's why Kenny. Ben has the miraculous resurrection.
Right. He just has a little cut on his head.
But there's actually a full prosthetic with a big gash in his head and his brain spilling out. I think somewhere there's actually a photograph of Ken standing by the prosthetic, which is hilarious.
Those Band-Aids do wonders.
Yeah, it's like the Dr. Loomis thing from the new Halloween, you know?
He got better.
Skull got crushed, but he got better.
It's tough to take down Joe Grizzly.
That's right.
No, what was like your favorite death scene in the movie?
Nice question. How? You know, it's like how can you pick your favorite child? You know. Wow, I don't know. I kind of liked the immolation of Vigo's character, and then the subsequent impaling on the what do you call that thing? You know, the spikes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like a kind of a booby trap thing, I guess.
Yeah. I know that there must be a name for that, and right now I can't think of it. But I kind of like that. I'm trying to think what else. Actually, when you really think about it, there weren't that many killings.
Yeah.
The drop hammer in the kitchen when the little girl, after we have our nice little family moment. Mm-hmm. She goes over, and that was some of the stuff that got us in big trouble with the MPAA, was as originally written and shot, she pulls the cord on the drop hammer that, kills Billy Butler.
Mm-hmm.
So
they weren't big on a kid doing it?
On a kid doing it, yeah. Yeah. So that scene was severely truncated.
Mm-hmm.
And,
Were you involved in that at all? Like the battle at the MPAA?
No, that was entirely on the shoulders of director Jeff Burr.
Mm-hmm.
And I would get periodic updates from him when it came time to have the cast party. They actually sent us an invitation with the MPAA X rating as the cover of the invitation. Because it was still rated X at the time.
Yeah.
And that was also part of the reason why we lost our initial theatrical date, is because of all the trouble from the MPAA.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
is that disappointing when you see the movie and when you first saw the movie and you saw like scenes that you knew were in it had to be cut out?
I was just so thrilled to see a movie that I was actually a star of that I couldn't find any fault in it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, no, it wasn't. Plus, I didn't really understand the all the nuances of filmmaking and releasing and things like that. You know, I'd never been that deeply in the process before to really know what was, customary and usual and what was, what was actually lost. I mean, I don't think I'd ever probably, worked on a movie where I'd had the full script before till then.
Yeah. That was the original script you got. Was it pretty much the same what you guys shot, or did it change a lot?
There were quite a bit of differences. David J. Scow, of course, was the writer, and there was one scene I remember from the original. It takes place early in the picture when I don't know if you remember it. There was a character played by Tony Hudson. She was kind of like one of our victims that had escaped.
Mm-hmm.
But she's like half nuts because of everything that's happened to her and stuff like that. And she bumps into Ken Foray in the woods and tells him, what's going on, clues him in. And then he takes off and she's kind of like walking around and, I grab her by the throat and lift her up and I impale her on a tree branch.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow, I don't know how and why I had the forethought to do this, but my saw was hanging up in the tree. So after I impale her on the branch, I grabbed the saw out of the tree and I started up. And it was originally written that I was supposed to split her in half from, crown to crotch. And then the two body halves were supposed to fall, apart. Well, that one didn't make it.
Could they not film it, or was it too hard to film, or did you guys actually film it and just you guys had to cut it out?
As far as I know, we never filmed it. I don't know if second unit filmed it or not, but I wasn't there. If they filmed it, and it may have been just a practical decision that it was going to take too much time and too much money to stage it.
Yeah.
I could be wrong, but as far as I know, it was never filmed. Mm-hmm. The ending was somewhat different. The original ending, Kate Hodge is walking down the deserted road the next morning, delirious from everything that's happened to her. She plops down on the tire, and that was all keeping in the original ending. And then from that point is where it changed. The original ending had a cop car with the lights flashing, mm-hmm. Come speeding past her, screech to a halt, and as the dust settles behind the car, the little girl stands up in the as the police car screeches to a halt and the dust settles, cut back to Kate Hodge, a sense of relief as she's being rescued, only to watch as horror wipes across her face, cut back to the little girl standing in the back seat of the police car holding up the leather face mask.
Mm-hmm.
And that was how it was supposed to end.
Yeah. Now, which ending do you prefer?
Either or. I don't really have an opinion on that.
Yeah. They both work.
I understand why it was changed, and that would have been fine. It would have been nice to work with Ken on the next one, and that would have been really cool. But it would have been equally as cool to end it on that kind of down note, knowing that Kate Hodge, her character, was going to probably end up dead.
Yeah.
So, either way, I don't know. I've never really thought which one I prefer, if you want to know the truth.
Yeah. Kate Hodge, where would you rank her with, as far as Scream Queens go?
Oh, she was very good, She was excellent. That movie was introducing Kate Hodge, and then she went on to do quite well. She got her own TV series, She-Wolf of London.
Mm-hmm.
She ended up co-starring in Brandon Lee's Next to the Last movie. What was it called? I can't remember.
I think I remember that now.
Rapid Fire, I think?
Yeah, that's it. I remember seeing the cover for it, yeah.
Yeah, and then she ended up on another series, believe it or not, a sitcom on, I think it was network TV. And then I sort of lost track of her. I haven't spoken to her in several years. She did quite well. So, and she was a pretty serious actress as well. She had said something that kind of really bothered me, and when they relayed it to me, and then I finally realized what the deal was. She had asked somebody, one of the producers or somebody, to ask me to stay away from her when I was in makeup.
Really?
Uh-huh. And, I thought that was a little, I was offended by that.
Yeah.
Until I realized what was going on, and it wasn't anything personal. That was her working process.
Yeah, to say so she'd be, afraid of you when she actually saw you in the makeup.
Exactly. So, I really, actually, in retrospect, I have to really respect that.
Yeah.
Makes sense. It was a good decision. It was a very valid decision. Mm-hmm. Because that's her work process. So,
John, I think we get some questions from the chat room here.
Yeah, first one off the list here. Body of the Beautiful People, they want to know if you ever seen the wrestler Leatherface.
You know what? Yes, I am aware of him. Strangely enough, one of my friends who was a bodybuilder over at Venice, you know, over at Gold's in Venice, in California, Venice Beach, California, the Gold's, he told me immediately after I did the movie that I should go, I should take the character into wrestling. And, you know, I didn't think about it. It did, you know, it didn't seem, well, first of all, I don't own the character. And I actually sort of always had contemplated going into pro wrestling. If I did, I didn't want to go as somebody else's character. I wanted to go in, you know, some kind of gimmick of my own. Mm-hmm. So kind of let that drop. But yeah, I've seen him. I've seen him, you know, because I used to read the wrestling magazines and stuff, and somebody actually gave me some tapes on him. And he's huge. He's like, at one point, he was a superstar in Japan.
Yeah, he's big in, like, the death matches over there.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, I know a lot, you know, and it is the... It's the Leatherface from Chainsaw 3 that he, you know, models himself after.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I believe he has I think he has to call himself Super Leather, so you know he doesn't get sued or something.
Yeah, I think in Japan,
for a long time though, he was calling himself just Leatherface.
Yeah, I think in Japan, it's probably different laws, or they, or maybe they thought they could get away with it. But
until the cease and desist order,
right?
I'm Super Leather now.
Yeah. More power to him, you know. I wish now, you know, of course, in retrospect, I wish I had, you know, taken that gimmick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so.
It was a pretty crazy scene, seeing a guy running through the crowd with a chainsaw and all, everybody scattering. So.
Yeah, legit.
Oh, yeah, the Japanese fans were terrified of that guy.
I can't
believe it. Oh, yeah, you know.
Yeah. No, wasn't that the guy that was Corporal Kirshner? Isn't
yeah,
that
yes, that's what I, yes, yeah. That's what I've heard.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Sure is.
We don't always tell all the guests here, but we also host a pro wrestling show on Wednesdays. But
oh, you do you?
Yeah. Since you were gonna think about going into it, you probably won't mind.
Not at all. Well, let me tell you something right now, brother. I don't think you know who you're dealing with. Luke Bronson, the Iron City Savage, 300 pounds of coiled steel and sex appeal.
Yeah, I think you missed your calling.
You know what? Sometimes in the wee hours of the morning when I'm pacing the floor and can't sleep, I have that same thought. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I kind of, if I could turn back the clock and do things over again, I think I would have given a much more concentrated push toward professional wrestling somewhere. And, you know,
yeah.
Somewhere.
To see what happened.
Now I'm wondering, though, do you think, like, down the road, maybe there could be, like, a Victor Crowley pro wrestler in Japan?
Mm. Well, now, brother, I think that my days of taking bumps in a ring are kind of, like, over.
But if you're truly crazy, then you can just go in and...
At least severely truncated, you know? But... What I aspire to, just as I aspire. Here's the two things I want to do before I shuffle off this mortal coil and before I hang up my my tights for good. I want to make a horror film about, you know, about bikers.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to make a horror film about wrestling.
Oh, that'd be sweet. Have you seen what was the Mexican wrestling horror movie?
Oh,
what was it? I don't know.
WrestleManiac.
Yep.
Oh, okay. No, see, I don't.
But it was more of a luchador thing.
You know what? I mean, every once in a while, I'll turn on the lucha stuff just to see what they're doing, but I'm not a fan of it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm all about bigger, better, stronger. You know,
which is that's a good
I want to see American. I want to see American monsters.
Yeah.
You know, so you know, I appreciate what the luchas do, but you know, that's fine for them.
Yep.
Yeah. Was, Anything else from the chat room there, John?
Yeah, the Raven Effect. He wants to know, what do you think of the prequels to Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
Okay, excellent question. And let me preface it by saying, if there was any movie that I wanted to hate to the bottom of my, to the pit of my being, it was the remake, the 2003 remake. I wanted to hate it. I wanted it to be so bad. I just, you know, because first of all, I wasn't even invited in for a hi, how are you, you know, when it came time to do the movie. Mm-hmm. Completely passed over. Couldn't even, they wouldn't even talk to me about it. So I was very disgruntled. And so I wanted to hate the movie, but I got to tell you, I really have to tell you that I liked it. I thought it was pretty good.
I dug it too. John's not a fan of it here, but I always thought it was a well-made movie. I thought it was one of the better of the remakes.
Yeah, I mean, I have nothing, no disparaging remarks to make about that movie at all. I liked it. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen the prequel.
Yeah, I'm not as big on the prequel, but the first remake was good. I think they kind of hurt themselves having the ending where Leatherface gets his arm cut off and they kill off the sheriff and everything, because then it was like real hard to make a sequel, so they had to make the prequel.
I wonder if that was a calculated move to sort of like invalidate all the prior sequels.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, like a psychological move. You know what I mean?
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
You know.
I don't know what they do after that though. You can't really have a one-armed Leatherface running around.
I guess you make a prosthetic arm that's mechanized a la the leg of Matthew McConaughey in Number Four.
You could do that.
I don't know. What else can you do?
You can make a sequel to the prequel, which would be a sequel to the remake.
Oh, geez, now my head is spinning.
The other one here, it's more of a, I don't know if it's not really a question, is it?
No,
John?
It's just kind of a statement, yeah.
Yeah. He just wanted to know, it's George Rushton from London, England. He said he's a fan of Leatherface and really enjoyed the scene with Leatherface and the electronic word game device, because you have got a glimpse of a big child rather than a mass murderer. Plus, I sympathize with his typing skills.
Oh, yeah. Okay, check this out. Okay, yeah, you know, a lot of people refer to that scene, and I'll tell you exactly how it happened, if you want to hear it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, like, you know, sequence, you know, as the thing goes on, you know, I have a little scuffle with my brother, and he throws my confiscated cassette tape in the fire, and of course I make him pull it out, and he burns his hand, and it's a little, you know, kerfuffle, and Mama comes in, now dear, go out and, you know, work on your lessons. So and then cut, you know, and then set up for the next shot. So okay, all right, now we pick it up. And you know, as you make movies, you do them in bits and pieces. It's never, you know, it's not like you start at page one and go all the way through.
Mm-hmm.
So we finally got to the scene in the workshop with the cassette tape. And, you know, I walk in, I throw the cassette tape down. Well, prior to filming that, the prop guy hands me a speak and spell. I said, what the hell do you want me to do with this? I don't know, do something with it. I said, okay, I don't know. So I sat there, and I came up with the idea that, you know, this guy's, like, hungry. He wants to eat. He's, you know, food-centric. His food just happens to be human. So I started scrolling. Okay, now remember, this is 1989. Computer graphics weren't all that great, and the speak and spell thing wasn't that sophisticated of a piece of machinery. So I started scrolling through the characters, and the only human thing I could find was that clown. Okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, my original idea was to find, like, I was hoping to find, like, Jack and, you know, like a Jack and Jill, or kind of couple, you know, a couple of kids or something.
Right.
Or, you know, some businessman or whatever. And then the idea, you know, and then when I see a human, the food. So the clown was the only humanoid on the character thing. So that's why I picked him, and food was, of course, you know, because I was hungry.
we're gonna start talking about your new movie here in a minute. But Kane Hodder was a stunt coordinator on Leatherface. And now you've gone on to work with them in your in the upcoming Hatchet 2. What was Kane Hodder like on the set of Leatherface?
Oh, great. Are you kidding? We had a blast. Kane and I have had a blast from the day we met. I think Hatchet 2 makes, I think, the fourth picture we've worked on together.
Plus,
we're also involved in a group called Hollywood Ghost Hunters. He's fun. He's funny. We have a blast. When he and I make personal appearances together, it's like mega super cool because we have, over the years, we've developed this repartee that, you know, it's kind of like half joking, half put down, half compliment, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, and we just have a lot of fun hanging out together and working together.
Mm-hmm.
So he's great.
So Hatchet 2, now how did you get involved in it?
Well, Kane Hodder and his good friend Rick McCollum started this group called Hollywood Ghost Hunters. Mm-hmm. And they asked me to be part of it. Chris Parnell, the minor 49er from Valentine's Day, is part of it. Daniel Harris is now a part of it. And the conceit is Hollywood horror professionals, you know, seeking the paranormal. Mm-hmm. So, and then Adam Green's part of it, and several. Actually, check this out. I think there were eight people who worked on Hatchet that were part of Hollywood Ghost Hunters.
Ooh.
And anyway, so that's basically how it happened. We'd gone to do a ghost hunt at the Sharon Tate House on Cielo Drive, and Adam was there, and Kane and I were just goofing around, having a good time, and Kane looked at Adam and said, "We need to put RA in Hatchet too." Adam looked at me and he goes, "You know what? That's a good idea." And I thought they were just, you know, talking, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And check this out. Then on Saturday the 14th, 2009, I get a call from Kane. Not on Friday the 13th, but Saturday the 14th.
The day after.
Yeah, exactly. Well, he was kind of busy on Friday the 13th. Friday, November 13th, 2009, he was kind of busy. He actually called me from an airport. And he said, "Adam wants you to be in Hatchet 2. Take the job." I said, "Well, okay, sure." And then Adam and I exchanged several phone calls. I was actually staying in an area over this course of several weeks where my cell phone didn't work. So I'd go to where my cell phone worked. I'd call and leave a message for Adam. He would call back later, and by then, you know, so it was like we exchanged messages back and forth for probably 2 or 3 weeks, and finally we actually spoke person to person, and, you know, he said he wanted me in, and I said, "Fine, you know, consider it done. Well, you know, whatever it takes, whatever the deal is, it's a done deal." And so that was it.
Mm-hmm. Now, what's your role in the movie?
I play Trent.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a badass, ornery, big, mean, tough, swamp man. And I'm recruited by Tony Todd, who reprises his role as Reverend Zombie.
Mm-hmm.
I'm recruited by Reverend Zombie to go into Honey Island and hunt down and kill Victor Crowley.
Oh, man.
Awesome.
Tony Todd, you know, a real small role in the first movie. Is Reverend Zombie like a bigger role in the second one?
He is billed above the title now.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. The above the title billing is Tony Todd, Danielle Harris, and Kane Hodder. Above the title, which means, you know, that's kind of huge.
Yeah.
And Danielle Harris came in to take over the part of Mary Beth, And she just, you know, I mean, she owns it. Even, you know, she came in to replace another actress from the original. Mm-hmm. It's her part now. She owns it. You know, she's so good. And, you know, I'll tell you what, I've never had so much fun working on a movie. It just, every day I went to work, I was so happy to look around and see who I got to work with. Tony Todd, Danielle Harris, Kane Hodder, legendary writer-director Tom Holland, the father of Chucky,
mm-hmm.
who used to be an actor before he became a writer-director, came out of acting retirement to do a part in this movie. Hmm. So every day I went to work, I was surrounded by horror icons.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, it was great. You know, and the younger people they brought in, you know, to play the, you know, well, obviously the younger people. They were all great. They're just such a fun bunch of people. I mean, we just a week ago Monday we had to go to a studio to do some looping and things like that, and a bunch of us all went out for lunch. You know,
mm-hmm.
It's a group of people that I've really enjoyed meeting, and I'm happy to know. As I'm fond of saying, Texas Chainsaw Massacre was my first love.
Mm-hmm.
Hatchet 2 is my new love.
Yeah. Now,
yeah.
We were talking before we went on air here about Adam Green, who we've had on the show a couple times, and he's actually one of the first guests we had on the show, and he's just a real cool guy. He came mm-hmm. on before we really had too many people on, and what would you say about him as a director?
I'll tell you what, Adam Green is the coolest guy in the world, and I am so thrilled to be drafted into the Hatchet Army. And I'll tell you what, you know, the guy is just, he's a ball of energy, he's smart, he's enthusiastic, he just absolutely loves what he does, and this is not my opinion alone, he's headed for big things.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, you know, he's somebody that's on the he's on the cusp of greatness, I think.
Mm-hmm. Had you seen Hatchet before? You know, you thought about doing Hatchet too?
I'd seen it on, you know, like on cable or something on you know, and I watched it because, you know, I knew Kane starred in it. I didn't. Kane was the only one I knew. I hadn't. When I saw Hatchet 1 on cable, I didn't know Adam at that point mm-hmm. or anybody else involved in it other than Kane and Kane's friend Rick McCollum, the co-founder of Hollywood Ghost Hunters. I knew him as well. So, you know, I watched it just to see what was up. And I'd seen 8x10s from the thing of Victor Crowley, and it really looked cool.
Yeah.
You know, character. So...
It's, you know, in my opinion, just a real fun, you know, kind of a throwback to the old slasher movies and just mm-hmm. great death scenes and just what you want.
Oh, my God. I'll tell you what. The body count has been ramped up.
Yeah.
And, yeah. Oh, yeah. In Hatchet 1, the body count was 7.
Mm-hmm.
Hatchet 2, body count 17.
Oh, rock on.
Are they all interesting kills, too? Because they're all... The kills, are they all interesting kills? Because in the first one, every kill is pretty fun to watch.
Mm-hmm.
These are pretty brutal, man.
Yeah,
they're pretty brutal. We've been doing panels and showing previews at various events and things like that, and the crowd has been on their feet screaming.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and it's darker. The Hatchet 2, you know, Hatchet 1 was a little campy.
Yeah.
Hatchet 2 is much darker.
Mm-hmm.
It also explains the origins of Victor Crowley. It's revealed, you know, where he came from. And my favorite part of the movie, for the first time in Hatchet history, someone actually fights back to Victor Crowley. And that would be my character, Trent. Kane and I, speaking of fight scenes, Kane and I have a knockdown, drag out, balls to the wall, raptor shaking fight to the death. And it is bad.
Oh,
it is badass.
Well, see, I'd go see it now, even if I had never heard of it, just for that reason.
Oh, I'll tell you what. Too, you know, I think Uncle Creepy on Dread Central said something like two behemoths going at it, mm-hmm. And we did, man. We just we tore. I mean, we literally tore up the set, mm-hmm. And it was really cool. And I'm very grateful to Kane. Kane was the stunt coordinator, you know. Mm-hmm. Again, mm-hmm. on this one, and I'm very grateful to him for allowing me to do my own fight scene without doubling me.
Yeah.
You know, because I love that kind of stuff. That's, you know, I had actually had aspirations at the very beginning of my career to be a stuntman. I was spectacularly unsuccessful at doing that, but I still love it, and I you know, studied, you know, a lot of that stuff. So, to, you know, at this point in my career, to still be able to do something like that, I was thrilled. And I think we delivered something that was going to blow people's minds.
Mm-hmm. You said about seeing it like people in like a group of people. What's that like to watch a movie like that that you're in with a big group of people and that they're making noise and just feeling like the atmosphere around them?
Oh, it's better than heroin.
Yeah.
I don't know. Actually, I've never had heroin, but I'm just assuming. No, it's phenomenal. Are you kidding?
Finally kicked the habit.
I don't know. No, we did. A ballroom main room screening a preview and panel at Weekend of Horrors.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I don't know however many people were in that room. On their feet, screaming.
Awesome.
It was cool, man. And then we came on stage, and I looked down the line, and then I'm sitting beside Tony. I'm sitting beside one side is Tony Todd, on the other side is Tom Holland, Danielle Harris, and Kane are right there. Adam Green's in the middle. Every day I went to work on that movie, and every day that I do something involved in that movie, I am just. I just shake my head. I can't believe what good fortune delivered to me.
Mm-hmm. That's scheduled to release October 1st, I believe.
Okay, yeah.
And, do you know if it's going to be a theatrical release?
Uh-huh, yes. Here's the kicker. At Comic-Con, Adam revealed that it's going to be released unrated.
Oh, excellent.
That's excellent, yeah.
Yeah, and that should be pretty cool. I don't know what company they're dealing with, but they said that they're making a deal with a theater chain to release it unrated, which will be cool because speaking of ratings problems.
Yeah,
I guess our beloved MPAA wanted, you know, not only wanted scenes trimmed, but wanted them eliminated.
Yeah.
You know, so the choice was made, and fortunately, a deal was, you know, in the works. So, yeah, it's going to be released unrated, which is very, very cool.
Mm-hmm.
So you will see the full effect of the effects.
Excellent.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Every gory drop of blood and viscera will be on screen. On the big screen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know last when we had him on, he had a lot of problems with the MPAA for the first one.
Well, now, you know, now it's you know, beautiful. It's a beautiful thing. And, you know, the distribution company, Dark Skies, and the parent company, MPI, they, you know, they'll also make it available for video on demand. So.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah,
that's a big thing with a lot of the movies recently, especially the horror movies, where you can get them on video on demand pretty much the same time they come out at the theater.
Yep. So we all have our fingers crossed. We're all very proud and thrilled with what we did on Hatchet 2, and we've got our fingers crossed that the fans will feel the same.
Yeah. Well, I've liked all his movies that he's put out so far, so...
Mm-hmm.
I'm really definitely looking forward to Hatchet 2.
Man, I'm pumped to see it, especially after hearing about your fight scene. That sounds killer.
It literally was killer.
I know you're a big dude and everything, and you can handle yourself, but did Kane kind of freak you out at times?
Not at all. Oh. Are you kidding? I mean, come on, man. I've known him for 20 years. This is the fourth movie we've done together.
Well, he's got that crazy look in his eye. I didn't know if he would, go off or anything.
I think he'd spook me out, I think.
Oh, of course. He may spook you out, but,
Yeah, but we're all about 5'7 or so,
Yeah, but no, I mean, come on. Like I said, first of all, as a stunt coordinator, he has this isn't the right term, but, I hope he has a fiduciary duty to deliver, the stunts without anybody getting hurt.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And truthfully, he takes the brunt of everything himself.
Mm-hmm.
I actually busted a cabinet door over his head.
Earlier
was supposed to be broke. That wasn't supposed to be broken over his head.
Oh.
Oops. Oops. But it looks good, man.
So we should ask Kane the question we just asked you.
Broke
a cabinet over my head.
Though I'm honor bound, speaking of heads, I'm honor bound from now into perpetuity. I have to state this. Kane has a bigger head than I do.
Must have a bigger neck, too, because I think the man's neck's bigger than his head.
Well, my neck's kind of big, too.
Yeah.
But here's the deal. When we were doing, I believe it was on Chainsaw 3, we got to, remember I said earlier we had this kind of repartee where we kind of poke at each other and poke back?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We got to, one night in the makeup room, somebody said something about the size of one of our heads, and of course, the other one had to take umbrage at that. And then, it was my head's bigger. No, my head's bigger. Okay, yeah, well, hey, wardrobe. Get a tape. And, I was sure. I was sure that I would win. Damn it. My head's 23 and a half. His is 24.
Oh, man. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. And from that point on, I was honor bound to say that his head's bigger than mine.
Really,
to my chagrin.
But he has hair. Do you have a... I know in some of your pictures you have the hats. I'm not sure if you had the head shaved.
I keep it pretty well shaved these days.
Right. So it might have been a half an inch for the hair.
Say that one more time.
He might have had the extra half an inch from his hair.
Well, thank you for trying to look on the bright side and pick up for me. But actually, I had a full head of hair when we measured our heads.
Oh, I was trying to help you.
He was giving you an eye.
I know, and believe me, I appreciate that. But once again, I'm honor bound to say the truth. And yeah, I had a full head of hair then.
Earlier when you brought up Kate Hodge and said like she didn't want to see you on set, offset with your makeup on. I know Kate Hodder has done that in the first Hatchet. He didn't want like any of the people seeing him in the makeup off the set. Did he do that kind of same thing on this movie?
You mean the other actors or media?
The other actors. Like he wanted them to be scared of him when they'd first see him.
Oh, yeah. Not so much this time. The way the movie is structured, of course, we don't even see... we don't interact with Kane until, the climax of the movie. I mean, of course he comes out and kills people, at regular intervals. But each of those are done, it usually would be just Kane and whoever the victims were. Mm-hmm. So there wasn't really an en masse time when we were all sitting around and Kane was Victor Crowley, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, everything's broken up into segments and pieces, so there just wasn't a whole lot of opportunity for Kane. In other words, the days we were working as a group, Kane usually wasn't, or he was off doing second unit somewhere. Mm-hmm. You know, killing the various and sundry individuals that he slaughters in the thing.
Right.
So, you know, it wasn't a, much of an issue. Plus, the makeup was redesigned a little bit to make it easier for him. Space section of the makeup was easily removable, so he would be in most of the makeup, but with the face removed. So it was Kane in a bodysuit when we saw him off stage.
Yeah.
So yeah, I wasn't aware. You know, if that condition was in place, I wasn't aware of it.
Mm.
Nope. Like I said, you know, Kane, Rick McCollum and I, and, you know, whoever else was working that particular day, we'd all hang out in my dressing room, you know? Mm-hmm. And so it was, that was our official hangout headquarters.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's hard to separate for me, especially, you know, it's hard for me to, make those distinctions, you know, I mean, when you get on stage, you act appropriately. Off stage, you're a person, you know. Life goes on, you know, whether you're making a movie or whatever, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Don't make the mistake that I don't take my job very seriously. I do. I take it very seriously. But I take the job part, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I like that, you know, when we're off stage, when we're sitting around goofing off, I like to goof off and play jokes and have fun. And, you know, step in front of the camera. It's whatever is necessary for that particular scene.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't carry that, you know, I don't carry baggage, you know what I mean? Or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
I can slip, I feel that I can slip in and out of character, you know, as the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
So, I personally don't need to maintain that wall. And like I said, you know, I mean, 15 minutes before we did the fight scene, we were eating lunch in my, you know, Kane and I were eating lunch in my dressing room, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I don't think you'd be able to tell, that was the case when you watched the movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
We're all different.
In other words, it looks like we're trying to kill each other.
Yeah.
And I did my damnedest. Damn it. I can tell you this. I kind of win the fight for a little bit.
Really?
Yeah, because Victor Crowley has no idea. No one's ever fought back.
Mm-hmm.
And
so something new for him.
It's kind of like the big bully and someone's fighting back to him.
He's stunned. He's momentarily stunned.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I get in and I put in some good, I drop a few elbows, and yeah.
Do you have a weapon in the fight scene?
Well, actually, throughout the movie, I'm carrying a high-powered rifle.
Mm-hmm.
Because I am the head hunter. I'm the king of the swamp. I'm the leader of the hunters, trappers, swamp men.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the one that Reverend Zombie insisted on coming, you know, on the hunt. So yeah, I have a rifle, and I actually shoot Victor Crowley at the climax leading into the battle. He smashes through the door, knocks Tom Holland down, grabs Danielle Harris, throws her up against a wall, and then looks. And I come into the room, and there he is. I shoot him. I shoot him in the head. You know. And then I'll be damned. Even though I'm the best hunter in the swamp, I ran out of bullets. I think it's kind of funny, you know, because. But be that as it may, so there's this moment, you know, where I rack the bolt on my gun, the shell ejects, and there's and the magazine's empty. Well, what do I do? What would you do? Course, you have to change magazines, reload.
Mm-hmm.
So, I pull out the magazine, the empty magazine, and throw it away, And just as I throw that away, that's when Victor Crowley slams into me and knocks me into a door jam.
And then it's
of course, you know, the impact, the rifle flies out of my hand, and then it's mano a mano, and it's on from there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's a real fight we want to see, man on man.
Huh?
That's a real fight we want to see, though. Yeah. Just man on man, no weapons.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. You know, I had to get rid of the gun. Otherwise, I mean, the distance was too far from the time I shot him till he could close the gap. If I wasn't out of ammunition, I would have either shot him more, or I would have used the gun as a club. So we had to, we had to stage it to make sense to get rid of the gun.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's the way it worked out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Though I think I would have. If I would have thought about it, I would have insisted on, like wearing a bandolero or something.
A jackhammer.
But I didn't think about it, and we didn't shoot the fight scene until very late in the movie. It was too late. Uh-oh, too late. that's okay. It works really well. And if you're thinking about that, then you're really not along for the ride anyway. if you're not along for the ride on this one, you better check your pulse.
Let me know too. If you go to hatchet2.com, you can sign up for all like the updates when it's coming out and when it's going to be in your area and all that stuff. So go to hatchet2.com.
Very cool.
Yeah. And we haven't done this for a while, but every once in a while here on the show, we have two different things. It could be two people. It could be two things. It could be two concepts. And they're going to do battle, and you have to pick who you think would win. All right?
I have to pick?
You're right.
Oh, boy, don't get me in trouble now.
And I wrote these out before the interviews, and it might seem like I wrote them up during because some things came up, but I didn't. But
I'm going to reserve the right to refuse to answer if it will incriminate me in any way.
All right. Well, we got the Saw's Family Chainsaw versus Excalibur.
The Saw's Family versus Excalibur?
Right. The chainsaw with the Saw's Family on it versus Excalibur.
The mythic sword.
Exactly.
Now, that is a fantastic question because... right off, my knee-jerk reaction is to say that the chainsaw, of course, with its, gas-powered horsepower,
mm-hmm.
would obliterate the Excalibur saw.
Mm-hmm.
But if you subscribe to the theory that Excalibur was a magical or quasi-magical sword,
mm-hmm.
get me?
I gotcha.
It may prevail, and... In the skilled hands, a quick stroke from a broadsword could bust the chain on the saw, and then you're SOL. So, my initial reaction was a chainsaw, but I think it might be, depending on the wielder of each, it would be a dead heat.
Mm-hmm. All right. We got a mask of human skin versus a hockey mask.
Oh, geez.
Or you can just say which one you like better.
Well, of course I like the mask of human skin better because
right.
that's the one I got to wear.
Yeah.
Well, I do like, and I thought about it a long time before there was ever a Friday the 13th hockey mask as something a villain would wear. And,
mm-hmm.
That's brilliant, actually.
Mm-hmm.
But in this case, for personal reasons, the mask of human skin... trumps the hockey mask.
Yeah, I think I agree with you on that one. Yeah. Grandpa versus Mrs. Bates.
Mrs. who?
Bates. Norman Bates' mom.
Oh, Grandpa.
Oh, yeah.
He's
a Grandpa,
good question.
100%. And that's not just because I'm in the Chainsaw movie. Norman Bates' mom was nothing but a mummy in a, in a swivel chair.
Mm-hmm. Grandpa had a hammer.
Yes, sir, exactly. Even though, he had to have a little help, at least he tried. So, yeah, Grandpa wins.
All right. CGI versus practical effects.
Practical, 100%. 100%, no equivocation. I hate CGI. I detest CGI.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, practical whenever possible, with maybe just a soupçon of CGI to
to enhance the practical effects.
Yes, but never ever to replace in any way practical.
Mm-hmm. Dennis Hopper's Lieutenant Lefty Enright versus Ken Foree's Survivalist Benny.
My pal Ken Foree.
Oh, that'd be a hell of a battle too, though.
Oh no, Ken wins 100%.
Yeah, he's much bigger.
Yeah, Dennis.
Dennis Hopper. You know, I mean, I'm not. I guess it's not. You know, well, speak ill of the dead, but Dennis Hopper was a runt. Foree's a big, strong man. Mm-hmm. He would obliterate him.
Yeah.
He's a big spooky guy too. You hang out with all the big spooky guys.
Yeah,
that is a fact.
Head cheese versus human chili.
Well, I've never had human chili, but I've been known to eat a slice or two of head cheese.
All right, so you're taking the head cheese in this one?
Yeah, I think just from because I know what head cheese tastes like,
mm-hmm.
and. As far as I know, anyway, I haven't had human chili. So, yeah, head cheese for now, human chili after a thermonuclear war destroys civilization as we know it.
All right. This one might put you on. I don't know if you're going to answer this one. Victor Crowley versus Leatherface.
Ooh, you dirty dog. You dirty, dirty dog. Let's see. Well, yeah, I'm gonna for my own preservation, and until all the facts are out, mm-hmm. after you see Hatchet 2, you'll know why I can't reveal everything. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have to set this one out.
All right, time limit draw.
Huh?
Time limit draw.
What's that?
It goes to time limit.
Hey, we're in wrestling now. Yeah, time limit draw.
Yeah.
For right now. Forfeit.
Double count out.
Yeah.
Double count out. Yeah, there you go. Double count out.
And this one I'd like to ask everybody is running zombies versus shambling zombies.
Oh, man. That is extremely tough. I'm going to
split my decision on this one.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I am one of the first horror movies I ever saw was A Night of the Living Dead.
Mm-hmm.
So that made such an indelible mark on me that I want my zombies shambling.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's okay. Now, but let's be very semantically precise.
Mm-hmm.
I want my zombies, my reanimated dead, I want them shambling. But I have to say that I like that maniacal, frantic kind of chasing. It just should be something besides zombies. It should be, people infected with weaponized rabies or something like that.
Yeah. Kind of like how 28 Days Later was, where they weren't really zombies. They were rabies kind of thing.
Yes, it may be splitting hairs, but I want my undead shambling,
mm-hmm.
And just, much like President Set in, Night of the Living Dead. Just they're relentless. Practically unstoppable, and will prevail by sheer force of number.
Mm-hmm.
I like those ravenous, just absolute, ferocious, maniacal creatures too.
Mm-hmm. I get you.
Yeah. Now I'm going to throw one back at you.
All right.
Omega Man, or the Will Smith remake.
Oh, man. And you also have the Vincent Price one, too. Last Man Earth.
I've never seen the Vince Price one.
Really? Oh, Last Man Earth. You should check that one out. That's good, too. But, you know, the Will Smith remake, I love the whole setup. I think it's really well made up until the zombies or the things attack him at the very end. And I don't know, it seems like they kind of rush that. They just come attacking, and then the movie kind of ends. But all the build-up, I'm really behind. I dig that. Omega Man's a lot of fun. See him driving around the car. This is a hard one.
Okay, let's be even more specific. The albinos from Omega Man, or the whatever they were from the Will Smith remake.
Yeah, I might have to go with the albinos because I like the other things in the Will Smith remake until they come running towards the house. I think they look kind of fake then.
Yeah, and that goes to one of your earlier questions, CGI over practical.
Yeah, I think that's actually a problem with the CGI. Sometimes they want to go overboard and have like 100 or 1,000 things running, and it just kind of looks like a kind of a cartoon or video game. And I don't know, I think just a group, 10 or 12 things or one or three or five, I don't know, that can be scarier than just a giant mass of things.
I was just heading there. I like that quasi-religious fanaticism of the black frocked albinos.
Mm-hmm. It's a little closer to the book too.
Is it? Okay, I've never read the book.
Oh, you should. You'd really like it.
Maybe I will.
Vampires in the book.
Yeah, you could be like me and listen to the audiobook.
Mm. Oh, really? No, I'll read the book. But yeah, that's what I kind of, like I said, that quasi-religious fanaticism, almost a post-apocalyptic inquisition kind of thing. You know what I mean? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's hard to fight against, I would imagine.
Yeah, I think so. You can fight against it, but you sure can't negotiate with it.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, hard to reason with that.
Yeah. This is the first time someone's turned the tables on us on this here.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, see, that'll teach you to call me. Do you have more questions on your verses list?
Nope, that was all the ones I had prepared.
Okay.
We knew you were going to be so good at it, though. We would have kept on going.
Yeah, we could have threw Super Leather versus Corporal Kirshner on there.
Who's the other one? Super Leather versus who?
Corporal Kirshner. He's kind of fighting himself.
I don't know. I guess probably, once again, a knee-jerk reaction, I'll go with Super Leather just because the gimmick's cool.
Yeah.
Mm. And I have a kind of a personal stake in the gimmick. So, yes, I want Super Leather to prevail over Corporal Kirshner, even though it's Corporal Kirshner, even though it's kind of like I don't know, what is that, a moot point or something?
I guess kind of like Shatner fighting, like, evil Shatner on Star Trek.
There you go.
Give him
all right.
A little mustache, and then he's, he's evil.
Yeah, exactly.
They said you were a lifetime horror movie fan. What, besides ones you were involved in, what was like your favorite horror movie?
Oh, wow. I don't know. Of course. Well, I'm glad you put that caveat at the beginning, because the ones I'm involved in, of course, are always my favorite.
Right.
I can tell you chronologically which ones affected me or made an impression from the time I was a child. The first movie I saw that ever freaked me out, believe it or not, was the original Invaders from Mars.
Yes.
I was a little kid. I saw it on a 19-inch black and white TV, and I was so freaked out by those. And that, so I'm telling you, that gives you an indication. A 19-inch black and white TV with three channels tells you how long ago I saw that. And then the next one was Night of the Living Dead, because as the zombie infection started to radiate from Pittsburgh, it started getting up in my home area, so the names started to get real familiar. So that one, the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, what else? Those are the ones that I can remember made the most impression on me.
Mm-hmm.
One that was not strictly a horror movie. I guess it is a horror movie, but the part that really bugged me more than anything wasn't horror at all. The Exorcist.
Yeah.
And the believe it or not, the part that bothered me more than anything in that movie was when they did the test and they put the probe down her jugular vein.
Mm-hmm.
And they moved it out, and that arterial blood started spurting.
Mm-hmm.
That unnerved me more than anything else in the whole movie.
Yeah.
That was real. I mean, that was, you know, mm-hmm. that was real.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to, you know, I don't know. I'm really a horror fan. I just, it's very hard. That's why I guess I singled out that aforementioned title way at the beginning of our conversation. It's just really hard to disappoint me horror movie wise, uh-huh. as long as they're done decently. You know, I mean, I could go through a whole list of titles and stuff I see on TV, not mentioning any stations, that just makes me want to puke.
Oh, I can't figure that out.
Huh?
I think we might know what that may be.
You know, I'm not gonna say, in case I ever have to sell a film to him someday.
We'll just pick a random monster.
Let me just drop one little hint. They sure seem to put a great deal of store in CGI.
Yeah, you don't want any of that to mess with your CGI, you know.
You know. Anyway, you know that. Anyway, I don't want to say any more before I, you know, before I muddy the water.
Now your guys' group there, the Ghost Hunters, like
Hollywood
Ghost Hunters. Do you guys have a website or anything? Or is this...
Yes, we do. HollywoodGhostHunters.com.
Okay, cool. We'll put that up on the website.
Yeah, please do. Thank you.
Definitely check that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, it's co-founded by Kane Hodder and Rick McCollum.
Mm-hmm.
Kane, of course. Jason. Rick McCollum starred in a movie called Dark Wolf. He was the Dark Wolf. Chris Carnell, the Minor 49er, and myself. And again, Adam Green, director Richard Friedman, and, special effects wizard, Robert Pendergraft, and several others,
mm-hmm.
all with pretty deep horror pedigrees.
Yeah, I'm on the website right now, and you can actually suggest a hunt, like if you know a place that's known to be haunted. And actually, right up here for me, Troy, you know that they say that graveyard's haunted.
Yep.
They actually filmed some stuff there not too long ago.
Where are you guys, in Massachusetts?
Yep. Troy and I are in Massachusetts, and John's in West Virginia.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. All right.
Well, that graveyard.
Yeah, I was down at. I was down at Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum last year.
Ah.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Now, where would you say is like the most freaky place you guys have like visited?
Well, I'm not freaked out by a lot.
Yeah.
We have the Hollywood Ghost Hunters was actually conceived in the Shawshank Redemption prison in Ohio.
Oh, wow.
We were all doing a movie there, and that place is one of America's most haunted locations or whatever. And that's where, as I said, that's where Hollywood Ghost Hunters was born. That place, I mean, you know, if you think about it, that place is pretty nasty, and if you let your imagination run away with you, you can think that how much human misery has compounded in those cells and on those cell blocks, that it's almost like plus the place is just so brutal looking. And I went down there. I'd been making several years before we did the movie. I made a personal appearance there. A friend of mine runs a haunted house, and I had gone in at like 9 o'clock in the morning on a gray overcast day and walked through the place, and it was just It was like you could almost feel the human misery there. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, that was one place. The Trans-Allegheny Lunatic Asylum is unbelievable.
Is
that place is, it, I think, if I don't know if I have my statistic exactly correct, but it's the biggest masonry building in the second biggest masonry building in the world after the Kremlin.
Wow.
Or institution, because it's 11 different four-story hospital-size units on 350 mm-hmm. acres.
Wow.
It's massive. And, you know, it was used until like 1996 or 97. It was still used as a mental institute.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty wild.
Yeah.
You know, we also went to the Sharon Tate house on Cielo Drive, which was the first thing I did with the Hollywood Ghost Hunters. And that was pretty cool. You know, because I was still fairly young when the murders happened,
mm-hmm.
and I remember them very, very well. And you know, to actually go back there to where such an infamous murder happened, that was very cool.
Mm-hmm.
And,
what's it like now? Is it still in
well? The original house has been bulldozed and rebuilt.
Uh-huh. Oh, okay.
And that's the house at the end of the drive where, you know, the murders actually happened. And the people that live there now want nothing whatsoever to do with the notoriety.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a guy about 500 yards down the lane who claims that the spirit, once that original house was razed, the spirits took up residence in his place.
Oh.
So... You know, it was an experience. I mean, just to walk on ground where such a notorious murder happened, that's pretty cool. You know,
You yourself, do you believe in actual like ghosts, or do you believe more of like when you're talking about human misery, just like the emotions are still kind of like entrapped in the area?
I am a skeptic. I don't know what I believe, really. I'm open to exploration. I'll consider anything, but I have to see absolute 100% irrevocable concrete proof before I will believe.
Mm. But you do think though you can feel like kind of the atmosphere of the place.
Here's what I think. I think your mind is a very, very powerful instrument, and you can believe what you want to believe, and it will be real to you.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever find like a guy in a sheet trying to like pull a prank on you? Doing the spooky voice?
Oh, I think we might have lost him.
Oh.
I hope a ghost as it comes, a skeptic.
We've lost R.A.
Yeah. Well, try getting back here and wrap up the interview. It's really good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
We need a proper finish here for such a great interview. So.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to break real quick, and we'll try to get him back on the line.
All right.
Might have ran out of batteries. We kept the man for a while. All right. We'll go to break.
This is Benny Chapman, the creature from the Black Lagoon, without your head, .com.
Neil?
Yes, yes.
I think I just changed my views. I think I'm now a believer.
That's what we were worried about.
How about that, man? I mean, my phone just died.
Yeah, that's so weird.
I how ironic is that? How? That's wild, man. I may have to re-examine my... I don't know if I'm even going to leave the house tonight. Wild, man. Yeah, it just went... I mean, I was talking to you guys and then nothing. No, it just went dead.
Yeah.
So, okay, well, that's one big red check in the plus column toward belief.
Yes, indeed.
We'll try to wrap it up here quick so they don't come for you.
Yeah, right. I better go out and get some garlic and wolfbane and holy water. Oh, that's old fat. That, oh, that's monster fighting.
Yeah, well, that's all right. I could have added the Hollywood Ghost Hunters versus the Ghostbusters to the battles.
Oh, the goat! We would slay the ghost. You know what our motto is? Okay, I guess there's one of these groups that has T-shirts. I better watch my mouth. I'll get in trouble. But I guess one of these groups have a motto: "Dude, ellipsis, run." That's their T-shirt thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Our motto is: "You run, you're done." Yeah.
Yeah. I think if I saw you guys coming, I probably wouldn't run.
If you're talking about Ghostbusters,
yeah,
we would kick their ass, no problem.
If they get slimed, it'd be all done.
Huh?
They'd be all done. I don't think they'd stand a chance.
But yeah,
we want to thank you for coming on tonight. It's really awesome.
Thank you for reaching out to me and having me on the show. I really appreciate it. I've had a blast.
Yeah, it was
also
almost,
this has been a lot of fun.
Yeah, almost 2 hours went by. Doesn't seem that long.
Mm-mm.
Hope it didn't seem that long to you.
You know, you're paying for the call.
Well, we'll love to have you back sometime.
Absolutely, anytime. Listen, I'd be thrilled to come back on the show. I've really enjoyed talking to you guys. Your questions are just really good. And our conversation has been free-flowing and fun.
Hey, this is Adam Green, the director of Hatchet, and you're listening to WithoutYourHead.com.